Now, to summarize what we were saying about temptation number one in the wilderness, we can say this: not just a son, but the eternal Son of God incarnate is rendering obedience that opens up salvation and life on behalf of all he came to save. And it's as though a dim ray of glory, a glory that will come in its fullness in the age to come, breaks over this narrative as Jesus obeys. But Satan will not give up so easily. He moves Jesus now to a second place, 5 through 8, to a mountain high place. 5 through 8, if you're looking in your text there. The devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I will give it to whom I will. If you will then worship me, it will all be yours." Now, 2 points need to be understood about the significance of this mountain. The first is that the mountain, as we've seen, is what? The religious focal point of worship. Whether it's the mountain of God in Eden, whether it's Mount Sinai, whether it's Mount Zion on earth, or whether it's the heavenly Mount Zion, the mountain is the concentrated focal point of true religion. And Satan, as it were, takes Jesus up to a high place, a mountain place, and there brings him into what you might call the glory council of the Antichrist, the anti-glory council. He brings him up and he shows him the kingdoms of the world in an instant, and he tells him that they can belong to him if he will but worship Satan. But a second reason about the mountain is that in the providence and ordering of God, it is a movement from wilderness to mountain that harkens back to the Exodus out of Egypt, where Israel passes through the wilderness and comes to Mount Sinai. And the temptation is very simple. Christ, Satan says, you can avoid the path of suffering. You can avoid the path of worship. You can avoid the path of obedience to your Father's will, and all the kingdoms of this world can be given to you if you will but bow and worship me. That is Satan's greatest desire. To have the worship and adoration of all. He wants it unlawfully and he wants it wickedly. It is similar to the strategy with Adam, glory without suffering, glory without worship. It's similar to the strategy used with Israel, glory without suffering, glory without obedience. But look at what Jesus says in verse 8. Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." What is the quote from? Here, it's from Deuteronomy 6:13. Deuteronomy 6:13. You shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Why would Jesus quote from Deuteronomy 6? Do you remember what Deuteronomy 6 brings into view? It is the what? Shema. The Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one, and there is one living and true God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and you will what? You will worship and serve the Lord your God only. You will hearken to his voice and follow him and worship him with whole-souled obedience. Jesus quotes from the Shema, from that context, to say to Satan, I am the incarnate embodiment and fulfillment of Shema. And you, Satan, worship and serve the Lord God Almighty and no other. Do you see it? Jesus, first, by appealing to our text earlier in the wilderness, Deuteronomy 8, now Deuteronomy 6:13, the Shema, and Jesus once again reminds Satan that the way to glory in the Spirit is whole-souled consecration to God. And once again, whose voice does Jesus vindicate? The Father who said, "You are my beloved Son. With you, I am well pleased." Now notice a strategy shift in the third temptation. In 9 through 12, Satan takes Jesus to the temple. Why the temple? From the standpoint of Satan, the temple is the icon of religious fellowship with God. The temple is the place that the glory fills, where God dwells in the midst of his people as high priests consecrated to the service of God engage in offering animal sacrifices so that a holy God might dwell with a redeemed people. And so it's an icon of religious devotion to God, and more basically, it's a reminder that God dwells in the midst of his people in his glory for their worship and adoration. But from the standpoint of this recapitulation of the new Exodus, what did God show Moses on the mountain in Exodus 25:40? The plan for the tabernacle dwelling of God that comes in time to be stationary as a temple. And so the movement is this. You have a wilderness traversing, mountain traversing Messiah who is now coming to the earthly replica of the glory of God in heaven. He comes to that place that according to Hebrews 8:5, by extension, is a copy and a shadow of the heavenly temple itself. And there, Satan changes his strategy. Look at this. He, verse 10, will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. Satan quotes from Psalm 91, 11, and 12. And let me give you the logic of it. Here's the logic. Satan says, you've quoted from Deuteronomy 8. You've quoted from Deuteronomy 6. I'm taking it, Jesus, that you are in your person and work the fulfillment of the Old Testament scriptures. You are a scripture-fulfilling Messiah, correct? He says, Psalm 91 says that God will give you angels to protect you lest you dash your foot against the stone. Jesus, do you see those stones beneath us? Cast yourself down from here, and Psalm 91, 11, and 12 will be fulfilled because angels will protect you from dashing your foot against a stone. Now I want to ask you this question. Why does Satan have the feet of the Messiah on his mind? Because in two successive episodes, the foot of the Messiah has bruised his head. And he knows that his only hope is to misdirect his feet from the path that he is walking. And so he quotes Psalm 91, 11, and 12. I want to show you what's so deceptive about the serpent. Have you ever read Psalm 91, 13, the text that he omits? Listen to 11 through 13. He will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent, you will tread under foot. Satan had his mind on the feet of the Messiah because he was being crushed by him in the wilderness and on the mountain, and he wants those feet to fall. Do you see? He wants those feet to fall in sin, fall in disobedience, fall in self-promotion. He wants those feet not to ascend to heaven, but fall to the ground and be dashed to pieces. And Jesus, knowing this, also knows this point. His feet came for one purpose when it comes to the serpent: to crush him underfoot. And so Jesus' response to Satan is to quote a second time in the proximity of the Shema, Deuteronomy 6:16. It is written, "You shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Is there a double entendre? I do believe it comes into view, but what is Jesus saying? Let me put it most simply. These feet have come to do the will of the one who sent me, and they will not step aside one way or the other. They are not feet that will do your will. I embody Shema, and I have come to crush you underfoot. It is there on the temple that you see the one who has come to raise a people, not to the earthly temple, but to the temple in heaven, to the highest heavens that Nehemiah 9:6 and Isaiah 6:1 through 6 and Genesis 1:1 says was laid before the creation of the visible heavens and earth. Jesus has come and he has stood upon this temple and he has said, "Now I am the one, Satan, who will not listen to your voice. I listen to the voice of my Father, and I have come to do his will, and his will means you are crushed under my feet." Satan waits, if you look at verse 13, for an opportune time. Look at that text. In 4:13, when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. The question is this: what is that opportune time? How do we find that opportune time? What can we find in the scriptures in verse 13? What is the opportune time? Well, for that, we need to erase here. And I want you to turn in your Bibles with me to Luke 23, 35 through 39. It's there that Luke makes explicit beyond debate that the opportune time brings into view the cross of Jesus Christ. Satan left Christ until an opportune time, and the opportune time begins in Luke 23, 32, and I'll read simply from 35 through 39. Listen. Jesus, in his absolute weakest point, is revealed to us in this text. And listen, the people stood by watching, but the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There's also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who was hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." Now, I want you to note this. How many temptations did Jesus face in the wilderness? How are they presented? Wilderness, mountain, temple, a threefold temptation, right? This is Jesus in the wilderness. Now, on the cross, I want you to notice this. In verse 35, what do you have? Rulers. Verse 36, soldiers. Verse 37, moving down to 39, there is a criminal. There is a threefold repetition of temptation, listen, that uses the strategy and the syntax of the serpent. What were the first two temptations, the first and the third temptations? If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. Temptation 3, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from the temple, for it is written, He will give angels to guard your feet. What you're getting is a threefold repetition of the fundamental concern of the temptations in wilderness, mountain, and temple. Same strategy, almost identical syntax. Notice the people now, and the rulers especially, join their voices with whom? They speak the words of the serpent, don't they? You can think of this now as a serpentine coil around the cross of Christ. Rulers, soldiers, and a criminal. And what do you find in that first temptation? He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ of God. Do you hear it? If you are the Christ of God, if you are the chosen one, let him save himself. Secondly, the soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, if you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. The syntax is identical to what you get in the first and the third temptations. If, followed by an imperative. If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. Again, soldiers join their voices with the voice of the serpent as he tempted the Son of God. And then third, and climactically, I want to spend as much time as we can on this criminal in 39. Because the criminal calls out in a bit of a different way that is the most subtle of all the temptations. That final climactic temptation, listen. He said, are you not the Christ? Listen, save yourself and us. Why is that so sinister? Why did Jesus come? To seek and to save the lost. And now, one who speaks the words of the serpent is crying out, don't only save yourself, Jesus, save us. How? By not dying a substitutionary and sacrificial death. This criminal called on Jesus, appealing to his messianic self-understanding, and asked him to abuse the conception of salvation and redefine it as temporal rescue from imminent death. That is not the salvation Jesus came to secure. But there is another voice in this narrative. Earlier in Luke, remember that the Father spoke from heaven. And what did he say? He said, "You are my beloved Son, and with you I am well pleased." And what does Jesus' voice do every time he speaks? He confirms the inerrant word of the voice from heaven as he walks in the glory of the Spirit given him in his baptism. And there's one voice, a lone voice, that speaks now to Jesus, and that is Luke 23, 40 and following. The thief on the cross next to him. Listen to this. "The other thief," criminal, "rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving what we deserve. But this man, Jesus, has done nothing wrong.'" Do you hear that? Listen to what he's saying. This thief, who has not, according to the narrative in Luke, been a disciple of Jesus, who has not, according to the Gospel of Luke, been trained by those who know Jesus. This thief confesses before the serpent and his offspring that this man is not in the wrong at all as we are. What does he do? Listen, he confesses his sin and the sinlessness of Jesus as he is dying next to him on a cross. He not only rebukes the other man, he not only says, "Stop," as it were, but he turns and says of Jesus what the Father said: "This is the beloved Son of God with whom the Father is well pleased." And this thief then joins his voice with the Father's voice and the voice of the Son. Why? Because this one, by the grace of God, knows who Jesus is. And then the thief turns to Jesus in verse 42, and he speaks directly to him. And he says, "Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom." He not only rebukes the voices that speak against Jesus, but he speaks to Jesus directly: "Remember me when you come in your kingdom," presupposing what? That when he dies, he will not remain dead. He will come in glory and power in his kingdom. And he says, "Jesus, when you do, when you suffer and enter your glory, remember me." Now, here's what I want you to note. Jesus did not come to judge the world in his first coming, but that the world might be saved through him. Elect Jew and Gentile, all of his people from the four corners of the world. What does Jesus say to the voices that spoke against him? What does Jesus say to the ruler soldiers and to the criminal? Nothing. It's terrifying. He says nothing. Why? Their time of judgment is future. They will hear his voice speaking a sentence of condemnation upon them at the end of this age, but he did not come to defend himself or judge the world at that moment. He came to seek and save the lost. And when the voice of a lone thief dying next to him calls out,
Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom.
What does Jesus do?
He speaks. He speaks. And he says, today, you will be with me in paradise. The end of this new Exodus is paradise. Paradise in the heavenly places.
Jesus says, I have come so that today you will be with me in paradise. Now, the response here, to put it very briefly, can be summarized theologically in the language of the Shorter Catechism. Listen to this. What benefits do believers receive from Christ at death? Answer, the souls of believers are at their death made perfect in holiness and do immediately pass into glory, while their bodies, still united to Christ, do rest in their graves till the resurrection. Jesus told the thief, in essence, this. He said, today, your body will be laid in the grave. But today, you will be with me in paradise. The end of this new Exodus in Christ is not Eden. It is not the temple on earth. The end of the Exodus that Jesus achieves is nothing less than the paradise of God in the highest heavens, where Christ, 40 days after his resurrection, ascends and sits at the right hand of God, making intercession for all those he came to redeem. So, this text in Luke 23:43 has parallels in other texts, such as 2 Corinthians 5:8 and the one we will close with, Hebrews 12:23. I want you to hear this. You who have come to this Christ have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God the judge of all, listen, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant. What Jesus told the thief, he tells you. He says, I open the gates of paradise. I open access to the mountain of God, the mountain in heaven, Mount Zion, where the spirits of the righteous, including the thief on the cross, dwell in the presence of God and join an innumerable host of angels in the inaugural event of worship in heaven. And you who are in Christ belong with him in paradise, belong with him in that temple realm. So what are you to do? Listen, join your voices with the Father and with the Son in the Spirit, and know that Jesus Christ, as the second and last Adam, by his death and by his resurrection, has once for all opened the gates of paradise. And what he has opened, no one can close. Abide in him and rise up into that paradise realm by faith, and worship now in the power of the Spirit in union with Christ. Worship now the living and true God as in Christ you ascend the heights of Mount Zion and know in Christ the paradise of God.